Let's talk about shutter speed, aperture, and ISO. All three things that you need to know without even thinking about it. Here is Camera Basics. Let's go! Amigos, this is Daryl Versosa and welcome back to yet another video, and we are just starting. Anyways, if you're new here on my channel, please consider subscribing and hitting that notification bell to be updated with content like this. Okay, so before we start, I need you to take note that aperture, ISO, and shutter speed all complement each other. You can't use one without using the other properly. You need all three of them, especially if you want to be fully manual and proficient with your camera, and maybe to be able to troubleshoot if there's something wrong with your image. Again, those three things are important and they go together. So let's start with ISO. Yes, ISO, not ISO. It's not an acronym. Take that, internet. Right, back to ISO. ISO is the setting that you might want to first set in any given scenario. The basic game here is that ISO is the sensitivity of your camera sensor. The higher the number, the more sensitive to light your camera is going to be, and the lower the number, the less sensitive. So you might be thinking, hey, why can't I just bump the ISO all the way up and get all the light needed and there'll be no problem? It's kind of opposite, actually. What? What? Keep your ISO as low as possible. Why? Because the higher the ISO, the more digital noise, more grain, weird artifacts, or are on your image. To see how ISO works, here's a little test shoot from my favorite Pringles can. From 100, 200, 400, 800, 1600, 3200, and 6400. That's for most entry-level cameras. For high-end cameras, the ISO can go all the way up to 12,800 and 25,600. Now, cheaper cameras will go up to 800 to 1600 ISO before it gets really noisy and grainy. While more expensive cameras will go to 3200, 6400 and above, and will still be pretty decent or usable.
Ooh, therefore photography in general, then what you're saying is pay more to get more fake light.
Right again, if you are outdoors and the sun is bright, I should make my ISO 100 or 200. If I'm indoors and there's not enough light, let's bump the ISO to 400 or 800. So remember, ISO is your camera's sensitivity to light or your fake digital light. The higher the number, the more light, but then the more noise. So keep your ISO low. Next up is shutter speed. Shutter speed controls so many aspects of photography. If you want to get someone running really fast, or a race car, or maybe you wanted to take a photo of your pets and they're running really really fast, and you want to make sure that they are not blurry, having a higher shutter speed opens up that shutter and closes it really really fast, stopping that action. So here's an example of my Pringles can, just to keep things easy, right? I'll be throwing this to the left of the screen. We'll shoot this at 1 over 320. So that's 320th of a second. Boom! That's super fast. You'll notice everything is nice and sharp. Good to go. Now, if we shoot that photo again, let's drop down to a 60th or a 30th of a second. That is much slower. So it's opening and closing over more time. But that also let my arms and wrist and other things move in frame. Because that shutter is not capturing it fast enough, you will start to notice a bit of an image blur. A good example of a shutter speed moving from fast to slow is, take a look at these waterfalls. With the water just flowing non-stop, a fast shutter speed stops that action or motion and you will be able to see the water clearly. But if you slow that shutter speed to like a half a second, 1 second, or like 5 seconds of that water flow, then it will look something like this.
Wow, so the total basics of shutter speed is faster shutter speed, less motion blur. Slower shutter speed, more motion blur.
Exactly. The last is aperture. Aperture is the size of opening in your lens. You can also see that happening. Take a look at this. You see those blades inside opening and closing. That very hole expanding or shrinking inside the lens is the aperture. The F symbol you see in your camera, that is the one. And here is where it gets confusing. The smaller the F number, the bigger the hole and the more light comes in.
So the higher the number, the smaller the hole and the less light comes in. Right?
Yes, and here comes the interesting part. The aperture mainly controls the depth of field of your photo. And here's how it works. It's how much is in focus in front of and behind of the actual subject that you are focused on.
So you're gonna give us an example of the Pringles can again.
Yes. This was captured with the aperture at f22 is what it's called. So that's a really, really small opening of light. But all the detail is there. You could see everything in the background. But we don't want to see all this stuff in the background. It's not the most pleasing background. So if we open the aperture all the way up, as wide as it goes to 1.4 or like 1.8, it's gonna make everything in the background not in focus. Now, we're gonna have tons of light coming in because it's open all the way up. So to balance the brightness, since there's less of light, we'll have to make that shutter speed faster so it's not capturing much light. And when you combine those two things together, you'll get an image like this. The background is more shallow now. It puts more focus on the subject now. Like you probably know before, different lenses are going to give you different results. Not every single lens can open up super wide. Some are longer than others and some are short. There's a myriad of lenses that do different effects. That's why we change lenses. That's why certain lenses give certain emotions. That's why certain lenses are used for sports, used for documentaries, movies. And that's what makes photography fun. Because there's so many different tools to tell different types of stories. Pretty simple, right? When you know those three things so well, you can look at the scene, you can look at the photo, and will be able to troubleshoot quickly. When it's too grainy, oh, my ISO needs to go down. If the photo is blurry, you know that your shutter speed needs to go up. And if the background is distracting, oh, I need to widen up my aperture. When you know just by looking at a photo on how to fix it, then I believe you have already mastered the three main camera basics. And for advanced photographers out there, I know that there's lots and lots of camera basics, the solid foundation and its elements. So if you want me to cover those things in the future, you know what to do. Click that subscribe button to not miss out when I post it. Hit that like button, comment your thoughts, I hope you learned something about it, and maybe share this video. Who knows? Maybe there's someone out there who's just starting with photography. Well, that's it for me. I will see you guys on the next video.